This is the second Sunday of Easter, and our theme for today is Do Not Doubt But Believe. So our scripture lesson is taken from the 20th chapter of John. And what I've done is to divide this up into two parts. I'll read one part now, and then Jonathan's going to read the second part, which is sort of the rest of the story, after I'm done sharing a few thoughts with you this morning. So the first part says, later on in the day, the disciples had gathered together, but being fearful of the Jews, had locked all the doors in the house. And Jesus entered and stood among them and said, peace to you. And he showed them his hands and his side. And Jesus repeated his greeting, peace to you. Just as the Father sent me, I send you. Then he took a deep breath and he breathed into them, receive the Holy Spirit. But Thomas, who is sometimes called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, we saw the master, but Thomas said, unless I see the nail holes in his hands or put my finger in the nail holes and stick my hand in his side, I won't believe it. And this is from the Message version of the Bible, which is a New English version. Well, we've all heard the story of doubting Thomas. We probably learned this as children in Sunday school. And it taught us that it was important for us to be believers when other people were bearing their witness of Jesus Christ. And it was better to be a believer without having to see for yourself. That was the message that I got as a young child. And you're welcome to disagree with me if you don't think that my understanding of this is quite right. But for me, it was a good story, but it missed the mark of what actually happened. And part of that was because I wanted to be fair to Thomas. We call him Doubting Thomas and kind of made fun of him, and we didn't want to be a Doubting Thomas. But to be fair to him, his skepticism about the risen Christ is only mentioned in the book of John. The other three books of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, actually suggested that all of the disciples were skeptical of Mary Magdalene's story when she returned from the tomb. Peter thought it was just idle talk. Women didn't get a lot of respect back then, and so probably the men didn't want to believe her. And even when Peter himself ran to the empty tomb, he was uncertain of what that event meant until he actually saw Jesus himself later on. So Thomas really wasn't alone. All of the disciples were doubting until they saw the master. And so is it fair for us to criticize Thomas unless we criticize all of the apostles? The other thing is that in the book of John, the Greek word for doubt is never actually used in this story, except where it has been mistakenly inserted in some translations of the New Testament. What it says to us is that Thomas was not doubtful, but rather that he was uncertain. And the uncertainty that Thomas expresses is really that not of one who doesn't want to believe, but one who is seeking further information and further validation and further clarification so that he can really come to a full understanding of what's happening before he reaches a final conclusion. And I actually like that very much about Thomas. To me, he was the rationalist in the group. He was the thinker. He was the one who was seeking new knowledge. And I've always called Thomas the evidence-based apostle because I believe that's what he was. In other places in the book of John, Thomas is actually quite devoted to Jesus. In the 11th chapter, he expresses to Jesus his willingness to die, following Jesus to Jerusalem if need be. Thomas is also a bit of a theologian, and when Jesus was speaking in some rather deep theological terms that were confusing the disciples in chapter 14 of the book of John, it was Thomas who was the one who was asking questions and trying to very much understand precisely what it was that Jesus was saying and trying to communicate to the 12. And finally, Thomas's desire for further proof in the moment certainly didn't limit his capacity to serve as an apostle once he did become convinced that Jesus had risen. And the legend is that Thomas was the first missionary to India, and that he was the one, and we talked about this and learned a little bit about it in our Sunday school class, in our Christianity class. He was the one who established Christianity in the country of India. Now, let me tell you something. India, the center of India, is 2,832 miles from Palestine. And I looked it up to be sure that that was the correct number. That's no day trip on foot. And it's much further than the Apostle Paul ever had to travel on any of his journeys. Even when Paul went to Rome, Jerusalem to Rome is only half the distance that Thomas would have had to travel. So he was a very devoted follower of Jesus and a very devoted missionary, if in fact that is what happened in his life. So my point is that we misunderstand this story if we think it's only about the believing of Thomas. What this story is about for me is the conversion of Thomas to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. And for that matter, it's about the conversion of all of those first apostles in the early Christian church. All of the disciples had been followers of Jesus through his life. They traveled with him, they knew him well, and they didn't always get him, as the scriptures made very clear that they were often confused by the words of Jesus. They failed to understand many of his stories. They failed to understand at times the examples that he used. And quite frankly, they deserted him when the going got tough. Peter, who is the so-called rock of the group, the one on whom the church was supposed to be built, actually denied Jesus three times that he even knew him. And so something special happened to those early followers when they encountered Jesus again in life after he had been crucified. And it wasn't until that point that the disciples really seemed to understand him more fully. They finally started to get what it was that he was about. And because of that, their lives were transformed, and they experienced what I would call a real conversion that had eluded them before his crucifixion. None of them were converted to Jesus before he was crucified and rose again. They were followers, but they hadn't yet become converted. And so Thomas just happened, because of the circumstances, that he wasn't there that day. He was the last convert, but they all became converts to Jesus. Well, I'm going to suggest this morning that we ourselves may also not have been converted, even at the time of our baptisms, especially those of us who came into the church in the traditional way, being baptized at the age of 8. What did you really know when you were 8 years old? Well, I'll tell you what I knew when I was 8 years old. I knew that I loved playing baseball in the summertime. I knew that English grammar in elementary school was extremely boring. And I also knew that eating school paste wasn't too bad if you were hungry and the lunch bell hadn't rung yet. Oh, one other thing that I knew was that girls had something called cooties. And if I stood too close to them, I would get cooties. And well, at least that's what my friends told me, and I believed them. So I stood back. But conversion for me took many years, and I think conversion actually didn't really happen for me until I really learned how to read the Bible in a way that allowed me the privilege and the freedom to critically analyze its passages without the added pressure of being expected to believe things that someone else said that I should believe. And so some of the things that I was told I should believe in my youth, frankly, never even made sense to me. But I came to a point in my life where I became converted to Jesus when I learned for myself, through my reading of the scripture, exactly who Jesus was for me. And he was, just as it had been for Thomas, it was a revelation, it was a new understanding. For Thomas, it was the need that he had to touch his hands to Jesus' wounds. And for me personally, it was the reading of the Sermon on the Mount that really allowed me for the first time to understand what it was that God was looking for from me, and that's what shaped my own transformation. It may have been, or it may be something else that was important in your lives that transformed and converted you to becoming true disciples of the Lord Jesus. So we shouldn't feel guilty if our faith is still being forged, but we should continue to look forward to those opportunities to have life-changing encounters with Jesus that will reaffirm our faith and our direction in life. And so this morning, I appreciate you giving me this opportunity to share a little bit, and I ask that God will bless all of us as we continue on our life's journey down the road to conversion, to real discipleship as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ.